Hi, everybody. My name is Louisa Sternberg, and I'm a staff scientist in the Research and Development Department at Thermo Fisher. And today I'm going to talk to you about image enhanced flow cytometry and how morphological parameters can spark a paradigm shift in cell population analysis and identification. So first, I'm going to give a brief overview of the presentation. We're going to talk about how the CytPix really builds on a great legacy of Attune flow cytometry and how we can get cleaner data through image enhanced flow cytometry, then how we can get do less sample preparation to get more data. And then I'm going to talk about some applications, including high throughput CAR T killing assays, IEFC to assess cell health after sorting. And then finally, I'm going to take you on a journey through the mouse immune system on lipid nanoparticle treated lungs. So first, let's talk about what IEFC is, image enhanced flow cytometry, and why we're so excited about it. And to understand this better, I want to take you on a journey of how you ran your first flow assays and showed your scatter plots to your mentors. And your mentors would say, hey, this is a debris field here. This is a cell. This is a doublet. And then you just believed them and you took that on and you went about your day and did your gating and didn't really question whether that was actually true. This is what we call faith-based flow cytometry. But now with the addition of a high resolution imaging camera onto your flow cytometer, you can actually check up on those statements and go more into fact-based flow cytometry. So this allows you to change the way in which you do your titrations, your isolation protocols, your compound screenings, and it allows you to get tighter margins and more significant data out of the same samples that you've been running all along. So as I said before, the CytPix still builds on this great legacy of Attune flow cytometry. And here I'm showing you a CytPix flow cytometer to show you that this Attune platform that we've built the CytPix upon has already been running for 10 years. So it's very well validated and proven to be really low clog and high throughput flow cytometry. And in addition, we have added all of these features to automate your acquisition more. This includes the CytPix Max, which is a plate reader that's super fast and can read a lot of plates all throughout the day. And then we've also added this, orbiter here that can feed microplates straight into the CytPix Max. And we've added this fluid supply here that's a 10 liter fluid supply that means you can run your flow cytometer all day without really interfering with your acquisition at all. And our CytPix is added to Attune cytometers with a 4 laser configuration, which includes a blue, a red, a violet, and a yellow laser. It has flow rates from 12.5 microliters per minute all the way up to a mil per minute. And then the specifications of the camera are detailed here. We have a pixel size of 0.3 microns, which means that we have a resolution of 0.6 microns and allows us visual detections of 0.8 microns. And then the image area is variable, but it can go up to 248 by 248 pixels or 74 microns by 74 microns. The image capture rate is very fast. We can take 6,000 images per second. And the number of images that we can keep is only limited by our disk space and our patience for file transfers. And then we're doing bright field illumination of the violet laser, which we can also use to our advantage. Now a couple of words on acoustic focusing. It is a key to the technology and it is a key to why we can do image enhanced flow cytometry on the Attune flow cytometers. Here I'm showing you what happens with just a conventional hydrodynamic focusing. And you can see that at low flow rates, the cells bop around a little bit, but then as you get to higher and higher flow rates, the cells are really moving really fast through the stream. And we're having a really hard time capturing the images of these cells, which means that the images that we do have of these cells are very blurry and indistinct. So now we're going to turn on our hydrodynamic focusing, which is going to center the cells all in the stream very nicely here. And then when we run our, whether we run our sample at 100 microliters per minute or 500 microliters per minute, either way, we get a very steady cell in the middle of our field of vision, which means that we can get very high resolution images where we can not just see the outside of the cell, but also some subcellular features. But taking the image is only the first part of the operation. Then once we have the image, we use software to identify and measure specific patterns and characteristics inside of the cell, such as the intensity of the cell, the entropy, the particle circularity, et cetera. And then we use these images and transform this image data into actual data that you can plot on the histogram plots and dot plots like you're familiar with your flow cytometry data, which means that you can very easily and in a high throughput manner analyze your cell populations and the certain morphological features that your cell populations have. And this is then combined with your flow data into an FCS file. And so you're getting two data sets, one of them very high parameter, 23 parameter data sets that you can then combine from the same sample. So here are some details on the area and the sort of parameters that we can get with our imaging software. And these include the area of the object, the perimeter, the circularity, the major and the minor diameter, and the eccentricity, which means how many protrusions a certain cell has. So now let's talk a little bit more about all the things that we can do with this new parameters that we acquire using the CytPix. So one of the first uses of the CytPix was bee distinguishing. And so we at Thermo Fisher, we have a lot of purification protocols where we use beads to purify cells. And then for certain QC purposes, we always want to assess how many beads are left in our sample. And that's really hard to do with Fluorescein CytScanner alone. So that's why we decided to use the imaging parameters on the CytPix to really help that workflow. So the first thing that we do is we use the spot count parameter to identify singlets. So then we only are looking at images that have one event inside of them. So here you see either one cell or one bead. And then we use the average norm of intensity and the entropy of intensity to distinguish our beads that have very low entropy and intensity and average norm of intensity, as you can see here. And this is because they their pixels are really closely packed together and very densely packed. And this allows us to gate them away from our cells, which have really high average norm intensity and entropy of intensity because their pixels are less well packed and they're more distributed over the field of vision. Additionally, we used the image enhanced flow cytometry to really improve some of our workflows and settle some of those old contentious arguments that we had in the lab. One of them was viability dye gating. We have a lot of different researchers from a lot of different backgrounds, and we all wanted to use viability dyes. So we do a lot of QC on viability dyes and titrate them up and down. And what we noticed in some cases was that there was a intermediate population here that we weren't sure whether to exclude or include in our live cell gate. So what we did was we used our imaging software to analyze the images from all of these three peaks here that you can see here. And the lowest peak, those are the cells that are excluding our viability dye, and therefore they look very healthy, round, and they have very regular membrane features. And then the cells up here in this highest peak, these cells are the dead cells that are not excluding the viability dye. So the viability dye goes into the cell and reacts with the immune reactive groups inside the cell. And that's why they're staining positive. And now in the intermediate peak, what we found was that there was really dead cells in this gate because these cells, they were so dead and so gone that they couldn't even accumulate the viability dye anymore. And so they were sort of staining intermediately. So going forward, we decided to always exclude those cells from our analyses. Another sort of workflow that we wanted to optimize is aggregate exclusion. So here I'm showing you all the different ways in which you can do aggregate exclusion. Some researchers like to use the width parameter, some researchers like to use the height parameter, and then there's also differences between the side scatter and the forward scatter that some researchers like to use. So we decided to take our doublets and we backdated them onto our scatter parameters, and we found that every one of the methods that we routinely use to do doublet aggregation actually includes some doublets. Particularly the side scatter area versus the side scatter width and the forward scatter area versus the forward scatter width. You can see some of these brown dots here are clearly in your field of the area that you would usually gate for singlets. And then we also looked at the forward scatter area versus the forward scatter height and the side scatter area versus the side scatter height over here. And what we found is that the cleanest exclusion method is the side scatter area versus the side scatter height, but that forward scatter area versus forward scatter height was also very helpful. So for going forward, we decided to use both of those parameters to gate up front before we do any other gating. So now you might be thinking to yourself, Louisa, you're talking a lot about these first gates, sort of simple aggregate exclusion experiments. I don't really care that much about it. It's not something that I like to think about a lot. Well, I want to show you how important it really is to do all of this gating properly, because it really has a big, profound effect on your data. Here I'm showing you data that we've run without the cleanup gates. This is just CD4, CD8 staining, not gated on anything, just gated on all events. And you can see here that you have a lot of double negative events, that you have a very low chance to distinguish your CD4 positives adequately from your CD4 negatives. And you have a lot of these non-specifically staining CD4, CD8 double positives, likely just dead cells that are incorporating the dyes non-specifically. So in order to get from this data to this very clean, nice looking data, all you have to do is do doublet discrimination on the forward and side scatter, and then use the lymphocyte gating and a viability dye to really clean up those gains. And what you can see here is that you're able to eliminate doing that. You're able to eliminate all of these double negative cells over here. You're able to increase your dynamic range between the CD4 negative and the CD4 positive cells. And you're able to get rid of all of these non-specifically staining cells to reveal a subset of CD4, CD8 double positives that's actually really incorporating the dyes and really staining those markers. And that's just a few cells, but we know that these cells are particularly important in COVID vaccination and infection. So it's really important to get a good, accurate read on how many of those cells you have in your samples. And before I conclude talking about doublet discrimination, I just wanted to tell you that the best doublet discrimination you can do is actually using imaging parameters. And to convince you of that, I'm showing you this data here. Here we have the spot count imaging parameter, and we've used that to identify our singlets and our doublets, and then we've backgated that onto our more usual scatter parameters that you might have seen more frequently. So here we're showing you that within this within the usual scatter parameters, you have most of your singlets are falling into this gate, into the singlet gate. However, we're missing actually some of our singlets because they're falling into the doublet gate. So now what do those singlets look like? Well, they're particularly large cells and cells that have a lot of internal sort of variability and some internal features that are really interesting looking. And so that's maybe why they didn't fall into this line of the scatter parameter, but fell a little bit lower here. So if you study only CD4s and CD8s and lymphocyte subsets, then you might not care so much about these guys. But if you're studying macrophages or a mouse model of inflammation, for example, then these rare subsets may be more interesting to you. So then you definitely wanted to include them in your analysis. Similarly, if we look at the doublets that we've identified using our imager parameters, we found out that 27% of those doublets actually fell into our singlet gate. So these are doublets that you're taking forward in your analysis and that are non-specifically contaminating your downstream gates. So this means that any analysis you do with these doublets inside of them is less meaningful and less significant and is going to give you more variable results. So really, in order to clean up your gates, you will increase the significance of your data very drastically. All right, and now I'm going to switch gears and I'm going to talk about something that the Attune flow cytometers have always done very well, and that is no wash, no lyse protocols. So for no wash, no lyse, what we do is we take whole blood and then we add antibodies and then we dilute the sample and we run it really fast on the Attune. And so we don't do any spinning down and washing the sample. We don't do any red blood cell lysis. We don't do any PBMC isolation. And the reason why we would use this is because we want to get at those rare populations that we lose when we're usually doing the spinning down and the washing. And or we want to look at those granulocytic populations that we usually get rid of when we're doing PBMC isolation. So we validated that this workflow works, and the way in which we're distinguishing here between the erythrocytes or the red blood cells and our leukocytes or immune subsets is by doing this 405 scatter kit that uses the first channel on the violet laser in order to distinguish these two populations from each other. And we've validated this using CD45 staining. When we identify the leukocytes using CD45, the population that we get looks very similar to the population that we identify by scatter. So now we wanted to add imaging parameters to this workflow to see if we can enhance the workflow and get cleaner data into our gates using imaging. And when we image those populations, well, is what I'm showing you here, we were able to convince ourselves that indeed these are very pure leukocyte populations, and they're not full of any red blood cells. There's no more red blood cell contamination in these gates anymore. All right. And then when we looked at other imaging parameters, we were further able to delineate four different types of cells in those gates. So here we're using the entropy of intensity and the average norm of intensity to really identify these four populations. And what you can see is some of these populations have very interesting internal features. Like, for example, this one here looks very granulocytic. This looks almost like eosinophils with its little vacuoles inside here. And this one here has a different kind of shading that reminds me a little bit of a basophil population. Now, we're still early days with this sort of assays. We want to follow up on this more and really identify these populations and see what sort of markers they express. But the eventual idea is to kind of take some of that identification burden away from flow cytometry parameters and move it into imaging parameters so that we're able to identify cell subsets only using their morphology, which means that we can then use more markers in the flow cytometry space to identify activation states or additional cells and just build higher parameter panels with the same amount of flow data. Okay. And then something else that we're really well able to do is use imaging flow cytometry to identify circulating tumor cells and detect circulating tumor cells. This is an assay that we, a sort of proof of concept assay that we did together with Gujit et al. And we published in 2023. So here we have a sample of PBMCs where we spiked in 1,000 circulating tumor cells, line cells. And then we stained these samples with EGFR and EpCAM to identify those circulating tumor cells. And then the cells that we get here in this gate using only our flow cytometry parameters, we counted and we found that when we spiked in 1,000, we got back 1,484 cells. So that means that we recovered more cells than we put in. And that is that can't be true, right? It's biological impossibility. So then we decided to add imaging parameters and look at these cells and see if they really all look like normal circulating tumor cells that we had spiked in. So what we found is that a lot of these cells were actually doublets. They were actually normal looking clusters, and that we really could clean up this gate more using our imaging parameters. So what we did is we added the major diameter to focus only on large cells. And then we added the circularity percent to focus only on circular cells. And adding these two parameters made our gates so much cleaner and made us really convinced that we were only looking at our circulating tumor cell subsets. And with this additional parameter gating, we were able to clean up our gates very much, and we got a recovery of 92.8% instead of 148%, which means that this published results are much more in line with other methods that take much more time and much more effort to identify circulating tumor cells. All right, So now I'm going to talk a little bit more about high throughput CAR T killing assays, because it's another thing that was really where we really were able to enhance our workflows using the imaging parameters of the CytPix. So here I'm showing you two different populations that we mixed together. We took some Ramos cells, which is a cancer cell line, and then we mixed them together with CAR T cells. And the Ramos cells we stained with cell trace violet. The CAR Ts we stained with cell trace for red. And so our assumption is that all of these cells that are in this positive, double positive gate here would be cells that are interacting with each other where the CAR T cell is killing the tumor cell. And so when we did further analysis using our imaging parameter, we were actually able to find two different gates here. So this gate here, what we would call an efficacy one, is a low circularity gate. And what we found is that when we looked at the images in this gate, that the cells are actually not interacting with each other. This is not an effective killing interaction here. These cells are just in the same space, and that's why they're fluorescing together, right? So only when we looked at efficacy gate two here, we found cells that are really close together and that are really interacting with each other, and that where the one cell is potentially killing the other cell. So this means that we were able to make a much more significant and meaningful gauge using our imaging parameters that we would have where we would have had way more variable data before using only flow parameters. And to make this even better, we added our CytPix Max to make the assay more high throughput. So what we did here is we ran our plates in 22 minutes for 96 well plates, and it would take only 88 minutes for a 384 well plate, which means that you can efficiently run about 21 96 well plates per day. And then we have these customizable options for different plate types, where you can also have, you know, micro centrifuge tube holders and deep well plates and all kinds of different plates that you can add to this. And then additionally, we have a passive cooling system that keeps your samples cold while they're inside the CytPix Max. And we have the ability to punch through foil covers, which means that you can cover your samples, and then the instrument just samples it through the foil. And one of the cool features of our software is that you can very easily use our software to make heat maps of your T-cell killing assays. So here I'm showing you when we're adding more and more of our CAR T-cells, we're getting more and more killing efficacy, and you can see that this is delineated by different colors, from the green being the lower killing to the red being the higher killing. And that makes it very easy to also generate these curves. And then finally, when we had the plates here, we put some of, we can do this in whole blood, right? Like I told you about before, where we have no wash, no lice assays, where we essentially add our CAR Ts of interest into the whole blood, and then we incubate it with antibodies, and after 2 hours we add media, and then we just run the whole 2 mLs through our flow cytometer really quickly. So this means that the combination of imaging parameters and of our Attune flow cytometer will give you a very nice reproducible, significant, and fast workflow. So now I'm going to talk a little bit more about how we combine our imaging capabilities with our sorting capabilities to check on the cell health of cells after sorting on the Bigfoot spectral analyzer sorter. Okay, so this was done on iPSCs, or pluripotent stem cells. So these are cell lines that are derived from somatic cells. They are stem cell-like, because we've treated them with certain drugs, so they're stem cell-like cell lines. And now they can be reprogrammed into many different types of cells. Thermo Fisher has many different workflows and services that are related to iPSCs. And so we wanted to collaborate with one of the other departments at Thermo to really analyze these cells and see if we can find out anything about their cell health and their cell quality after we sorted them on the Bigfoot. So this is how we did the assay. We used anti-TRA-160 conjugated to alexaflor as a marker of pluripotency. And then we also used the Cytox red to identify live cells. And here's how we did the gating. We just wanted to get cells that are negative for the Cytox red and positive for TRA-160. And so here we're comparing cells pre and post sorting on the CytPix. And what you can see here is that before we sort on the Bigfoot, we have a lot less singlets. We only have about 60% singlets. And we have a lot of these eccentric cells. And this is what the eccentric cells look like. They have a lot of protrusions on their surfaces. They have a lot of irregular cell features. That one, this one looks like it's about to divide. And then we also have some that look like octopuses. So after sorting, we are really able to increase the percentage of singlets here, and then also decrease the percentage of these eccentric cells and increase the percentage of these round cells that are really even and have very even membrane features and look really healthy and normal, and like they're ready to grow and differentiate. So now one final story that I would like to tell you is about our efforts to identify immune cell subsets using the CytPix in complex mouse models. So Thermo Fisher has a lot of different groups, and one of the groups is really interested in lipid nanoparticle vaccination, and especially lipid nanoparticles for mRNA delivery. So they gave us three different groups of mice. The group one was only treated with saline. The group two was treated with lipid nanoparticles that contained unmodified RNA. This is double-stranded DNA, RNA that will be recognized by the immune system and then will cause inflammation inside of the organs that it is introduced to. And then the group number three here also had lipid nanoparticles, but here the RNA was modified. So it was capped on the 5' end, which makes it invisible to the immune system. So this one will not cause any inflammation due to the RNA, and it's a great way to test if the lipids themselves have any effect or on the immune system and cause any inflammation. So here is the panel that we ran in order to see if we have any immune changes inside of the mouse lung that we were looking at. This panel is designed to identify many different subsets from many different parts of the immune system, including innate and in adaptive immune subsets, as well as some of the tissue cells. Please note here that we also have a space for GFP, which is the label of the lipid nanoparticles and how we were able to identify them. And then we have two empty spaces here that allow you to add your own markers to this panel if you wanted to run the panel yourself. So the first thing we wanted to do is to identify the where the GFP lipid nanoparticles were going. And so for that, we looked at the non-hematopoietic subsets because that's where they were kind of targeted to. So we looked at CD45 negative cells, and then we were able to identify epithelial cells over here using EpCAM, and then endothelial cells using CD31 and SCA1. And we confirmed the identity of these endothelial cells also using CD144. And so then when we treated our mice with these lipid nanoparticles, what we found was that we all of a sudden got GFP positive events in this gate. And then these GFP positive cells were mostly CD45 negative, and they were mostly endothelial cells. And then most of them were CD144 positive. However, what we also found was that when we treated the mice with our lipid nanoparticles, there wasn't really a significant change in the amount or frequency of the endothelial cells. However, other cell subsets changed quite significantly, and this was a particular subset that were part of the immune system. So here we're looking at the immune cells in the mouse lung using CD45 as a marker first, and we're able to identify CD3 negative cells that were either B cells because they were B220 positive, or various cell subtypes from the macrophage and monocyte lineages, including alveolar macrophages, interstitial macrophages, and non-classical monocytes, We were also able to identify some of the CD103 and cyclic F expression on these AMs and IM cells. Furthermore, we were able to delineate the different types of dendritic cell subsets, including the CDC2s and the CDC1s. And then in the adaptive arm of the immune system, we were able to gate for CD4 and CD8 to identify different types of those subsets. And then we were able to look at the activation and memory status of these cells using SCA1, Ly6C, CD44, and CD62L. So here is an overview of the 9 subsets that changed the most within our samples. And you can see here that these subsets are distributed over the T cells, some B cell subsets, and then also some cells of the innate immune system changed quite a lot, including the alveolar and the interstitial macrophages. And from this data, we could also conclude that the large changes in the mouse lung were caused by treatment with the unmodified lipid RNA containing lipid nanoparticles, so the ones that had the uncapped RNA in them. And then there was very few changes in the lungs treated that with the 5' modified lipid nanoparticles. And then that led us to conclude that the inflammation is not due to the lipid nanoparticles, but due to the RNA inside of the lipid nanoparticles. But we wanted to follow up further on these cells. So another thing that we did using this panel was we did sorting of the subsets that changed quite frequently. So this sorting was performed with a 6-laser Bigfoot with 100 micron nozzle and purity mode. And when we did all this work, what we found is that 2 subsets became quite interesting to us. This one here is the SCA1 positive CD8 subset, also known as the TECSCSMs, because they're stem cell-like CD8 cells. And then down here, we have these plasma cytodendritic cells, or PDCs, that also changed quite significantly. So when you see here, I'm showing you the plots that where you can see that these cells went from 17% to 63%, and this cell subset went from 1% to almost to over 5%. And so our collaborators grew concerned that this cells are actually not the same cells that are increasing in frequency, but that instead our flow gates are getting contaminated by other subsets. And there's actually multiple cell subsets in this gate now, and that we're not getting really rigorous analysis. So we were thinking about how can we convince them that these cells are actually the right cells. And so we turned to the CytPix. And we asked these 2 questions. Question number 1 is, can we distinguish cell subsets that we've sorted from each other using morphological analysis? And the other question was, can we compare the morphology of our PDCs and our TCSCSM cells before and after we treat the mice? So here is some of the analysis on whether we can distinguish different subsets. And what you can see is actually that yes, different subsets look different using the CytPix. These alveolar macrophages over here that we were kind of worried were contaminating our gates are actually much larger than our immune cells like the TCSCSMs. And I'm showing you here as a comparison, also epithelial cells that are also quite more large. So there's a lot of parameters that we could have looked at, and we looked at 6 different parameters to ascertain whether the TCSCMs and the PDCs were changing any morphology before and after treatment. So we analyzed 6 different parameters. I'm only showing you 2 here, and those are size parameters. So we wanted to see if the TCSCMs changed size after treatment, or whether there was a mixture of different size cells, which would indicate that there's another subset contaminating our gates. And what we found was that the TCSCMs and the PDCs, they looked exactly the same before and after treatment. And this led us to conclude that this is actually the same cell, and it is just more frequent instead of any contamination occurring here. So with this, I would like to conclude this story and talk a little bit more about beer. Why am I showing you beer? Because on a regular flow cytometer, beer is just dots on plots. But when you look at beer with a CytPix, you can actually see that it's a complex co-culture of different microorganisms. So here on the top, we have some of these filamentous bacteria. These are bacteria that are causing the sour taste in your beers, that are making your Belgian ales taste funky, and that are giving the beers their specific and individual characteristics. On the bottom here, we have Saccharomyces cerevisiae, our yeast that is turning our sugar into alcohol. That's really the workhorse of the beer that's giving you the buzz. And so why I'm not just showing you this because I love beer and I'm super excited about beer and I think it's really cool to see this, but also because I want you to think about the beer in your research. What are some of the cells that could potentially be changing morphology, could potentially be having different phenotypes before and after treatment or in different disease models? And what sort of data are you leaving on the table by not looking at morphological parameters? And with that, I'd like to thank you guys all for your attention and for coming to look at this seminar today.